Hello there, and you're very welcome to a special programme celebrating Charity Trustees Week 2023. My name is Ronan Tierney, and over the next hour we'll be recognising and celebrating the contribution that voluntary trustees make to charities and community and voluntary organisations across the country. This broadcast is a co-production between Pobal, who manage a range of programmes that promote social inclusion on behalf of government, and CRAOL, the network of community radio stations in Ireland. And I think this is the fourth year that both organisations have worked together to produce this celebration of trustees. The programme itself will be broadcast across all community radio stations in the country this week, and thanks to both Pobal and CRAOL for taking the initiative in this regard. The theme for 2023 is Making a Difference, and a range of organisations are contributing to Charity Trustees Week. Obviously, the Charities Regulator itself, who's the lead organisation in organising the events this week. You've also got Pobal, Boardmatch Ireland, Carmichael, The Wheel, Volunteer Ireland, Charities Institute Ireland and Dochas. So a number of different stakeholders involved in promoting this week. You can check out charitiesregulator.ie for more information on the week, and you can keep up to date with all that's happening via hashtag TrusteesWeekIRL. It's really about celebrating and thanking trustees for the key role that they play in the governance and leadership of Ireland's charities, highlighting the importance of good governance of boards and highlighting the need for new trustees to come forward and connect with charities in their community or in their region. Later in the programme, I'll be joined by a number of guests to discuss the importance of trustees and the important role that they play across so many organisations that are vital to our everyday lives. Alan Cox and Keith McCarthy will share their experience of becoming trustees in different charities, Alan with AsIAm and Keith with Outhouse. Hannah Coleman from Boardmatch Ireland will talk to us about her organisation, what they do in relation to supporting charities in finding trustees, and Hannah herself indeed is a trustee, and it'd be great to hear from her and her experience. We'll also speak with Anna Shakespeare, the CEO of Pobal, about the significant role that trustees play in the oversight and delivery of funding programmes on behalf of government and the EU in a year when Pobal is celebrating its 30th anniversary. But my first guest today is Helen Martin, who is CEO of the Charities Regulator, the lead organisation in organising Charity Trustees Week. Helen, you're really welcome to the programme.
Thanks very much. Thanks for having me on, Ronan.
Yeah, delighted to have you on. And well done again to the Charities Regulator for taking the initiative in celebrating the unique contribution that trustees make to Irish society. Tell us a little bit first, Helen, in relation to the role of the Charities Regulator.
Well, the role, Ronan, is that we're there to regulate the charity sector in the public interest. That's a key part of our role. What we do is to ensure that there's compliance with charity law, and also we support best practice in the governance and administration of charities. So you just touched on there the whole area of governance, and that's pretty much key for all charities and all charity trustees that would be listening to you today.
Excellent. And tell us, the word trustee sometimes can be maybe a little bit confusing. People, you know, are familiar with board members, committee members and so on. The term trustee, sometimes I find it can throw people a little bit. Can you tell us what is a trustee?
Yeah, so as you know, we have thousands and hundreds of thousands of volunteers all around Ireland who help out in charities. But there are around 76,000 volunteers that take on a special role in terms of being a charity trustee. And what that means is that they are the people who control and are legally responsible for what happens in a charity. So if you're involved in a charity, and it's a company, for example, they will be the directors of the company. They'll be, you know, your board, or they might be known as committee members as well.
And Making a Difference is this year's theme. What difference do you think trustees make?
Well, trustees, as I said, are the ones who are exercising overall control, but they also set the tone for the charity. And the special role that they have is to make sure that charities are governed well, you know, that they're well run. And that means that the charity can ultimately get out there and do what it is that they were set up to achieve, and to help the different people that they were set up to help. Without that really strong governance framework, without the kind of procedures and oversight of finances, it wouldn't be possible for charities to get out there on the ground and help people. So it's a really, really important role that charity trustees out there in Ireland take on. And that's why this week is so important. It's really to acknowledge that and the special role that they play.
So they're really central to the delivery of so many services, of so many supports that are out there in the community that are delivered by charities, either through, you know, charities, you know, raising their own funds through fundraising, or, you know, working on behalf of government, you know, to deliver services. So they're absolutely key, aren't they, to the delivery of that work?
They are. And, you know, they're volunteers. And that's the crucial thing to remember as well. So the value of what they do in this particular role is oftentimes unseen, and it's really not understood. We had a report out there recently about the social and economic impact of charities more generally, and that showed the real economic impact. But of course, the thing that it's really hard to estimate is the social impact, the impact that having local charities and larger national charities have on society as a whole. Now, as part of Charity Trustees Week, we're publishing a special report in relation to what we call smaller charities. So they are charities that would have income of less than 100,000. And most of those charities would tend to be entirely volunteer led, which means that they would have very few, if any, paid employees. So they are particularly reliant on volunteers more generally, but also obviously their charity trustees in terms of providing that leadership and making sure that the charity has strong structures in place so that when donations come in, everybody understands what donations have come in, what they're to be used for. They can only be used to advance the particular charity's stated purpose, and just ensuring that those controls are in place.
And that's quite interesting, Helen, isn't it? Because, you know, for some of the larger charities that we might be familiar with through the media, you know, they often have a staff infrastructure in place that shares some of the responsibilities around governance are delivered by the management. And obviously, a number of the responsibilities around governance are reserved for the trustees. But in some ways, there is that support structure there in within the larger charities. But the smaller ones that you're referencing, they do have a huge dependency, don't they, on their trustees?
They absolutely do. And that's really why the guidance that we do is a lot of the times targeted towards what we call the smaller charities and the less complex in some cases. But that's not always the case, because, you know, smaller charities, around 18% of them had employees. Now, when you look at charities overall, it's 43% of them. When you look at smaller charities as well, you see that for every 10,000 euro in income, they'll have just over 7 volunteers. Whereas if you look at the largest charities, for every 10,000 in income, they'll have less than 1% of volunteers. So the value and the input that volunteers provide in smaller charities is a lot more significant. And as you say, they're far more reliant on their volunteers more generally. I would say absolutely, you know, your larger charities will have that backup. They'll have an executive team there, but they still have a hard job as well, you know, in terms of ensuring that they're providing that oversight and that they are providing that leadership to those paid employees and those executive teams. In the smaller charities, as you rightly point out, what you'll often find is that your volunteers, and particularly your charity trustees, they'll also be volunteering in terms of service delivery maybe as well. They might have a dual role. But what's really, really important there is that the charity trustees understand that the real value and the really important piece of that role is actually ensuring that the charity is well run. Because as you can imagine, things can kind of fall apart if there isn't that structure in place. But thankfully, as I said, we've got a huge number of charity trustees in Ireland with over 76,000. So a lot of people have stepped up and are willing to take on that role, which is really important in local communities in particular.
Absolutely, absolutely. You mentioned earlier, Helen, a little bit about the guidance and support through the regulator. Can you tell us a little bit of what type of supports you provide as an organisation to assist trustees in the work they do?
So we have a huge amount of published guidance, Ronan. So I would say for anybody who's looking to be a charity trustee, we have a specific piece of guidance around that. I would also say to everybody, even if you're an existing registered charity and you're an existing charity trustee, to look at our guidance about what is a charity. Because I think sometimes people can forget what their role is. And also you want to make sure that as a charity, you don't drift off into purposes and activities that don't directly directly support your charitable purpose. Where that happens, you risk your charity coming off the register because you may unwittingly have become an entity that's no longer considered to be a charity. Now, that happens very rarely, I should say. But it is really important that people connect in with that guidance. We also have a whole suite of guidance and templates and all kinds of documents to provide practical assistance to charity trustees, particularly the smaller charities. And we have those in relation to our governance code. So we call it the governance code toolkit. And in that, you'll find things like, you know, how do you prepare minutes and a template for that? And there's also information there for charities around risk. You know, it's really important that charities, no matter what size they are, understand the risks that their particular charity faces, because every organisation, including ourselves, we have risks that we have to mitigate and that we have to provide for and that we have to be aware of. And so there's some really good guidance there for smaller charities around that. And when I talk about risk for people maybe in smaller charities, what I'm talking about there is really the kind of thing that keeps you awake at night in relation to your charity. You know, what are the things that you know you have to keep your eye on and that you have to make sure you're prepared for and that you're addressing as a charity?
Excellent. So it sounds like a lot of resources there that are available through your website, charitiesregulator.ie. Just turning our attention, Helen, to the week that's in it, Charity Trustees Week. And I know that every year, the regulator plus your partner organisations, there is a series of events happening. Can you give us a flavour of what's in store this year throughout the week?
Yeah, so there, as you say, there's a number of organisations that are involved with the Charities Regulator on this. Boardmatch Ireland, Carmichael, Charities Institute Ireland, Docus, Pobal, The Wheel, Volunteer Ireland. And each of the different organisations is going to have a number of events over the week. And so what I'd be saying to people out there who might be curious or interested in becoming a charity trustee to learn how you can get involved, or if you're already a charity trustee, you'll find some good topics there. In terms of the Charities Regulator, we're hosting two events. One of them is online. That's a webinar, and it's relating to that report on smaller charities that I just mentioned there that we'll be publishing. And we'll have Mandy Osborne, who's our research manager, and she'll be presenting the highlights from that research. And really the idea of that is to increase the understanding of smaller charities and the public's understanding of that and the really important role that they play by that really large group, because you know they're almost half of all charities when schools are excluded. So they're a really significant sector of the overall sector. So we also note from our research that the highest levels of trust are for smaller local charities, and that's reflected in donations, with 37% of all donations going to local charities. So that's going to be a really interesting webinar. Then on Tuesday, we're having a hybrid event, and the title for that is Good Governance in Practice. And as I said, it's a hybrid event, so we'll be in person in Kilkenny in the River Court Hotel, and it'll also be online. And speakers include myself as Chief Executive, also Thomas Mulholland, our Director of Compliance and Enforcement, and a number of charities from local charities in the area, because we want to really know what are people's practical experiences of good governance, and in particular applying and implementing the governance code. So there are two events. There will be other events across the week organised by our partners. The topics they're going to cover are volunteer engagement, impact management, finances, compliance and board management, and links and details to all of those events are available on our Charity Trustees Week page on the charitiesregulator.ie website, and there's an interactive calendar there, so you'll be able to click into the calendar and get all the details of the different events. There'll also be some videos of the events, and they'll be up on our website for a period after Charity Trustees Week, and that's for charity trustees out there who for whatever reason can't make it to particular events. We want to make sure that they can still avail of whatever learnings that are available on those particular events. And that's something that we endeavour to do with all our events, actually, in the Charities Regulator. We always try and make sure that there are videos of them available to people after the event so that people can dip in and out of them.
That's a great idea, Helen, yeah, because I think for a lot of people, you know, it may not suit on the particular evening, or it might clash with a meeting of their own organisation, or there's going to be something else going on. So it's great to have those recordings there. Helen, thank you so much for joining us today, and best of luck with everything that's happening throughout the week. charitiesregulator.ie for further information relating to all that's happening across all the different partner organisations who are making a contribution to Charity Trustees Week. So thank you very much, Helen.
Thanks, Ronan.
For more information on Community Radio, check out www.crail.ie and follow us on Facebook.
And our next guest on the programme is Hannah Coleman, who's Communications and Education Manager with Boardmatch Ireland. Hannah, you're very welcome to our Charity Trustees Week special programme.
Thank you very much, Roland. Thanks for having me.
Delighted to have you, Hannah. And first of all, maybe just tell us a little bit about Boardmatch Ireland and the work that you do.
Sure. So Boardmatch is a registered charity and we provide board recruitment, training and support services to charities and not-for-profits around Ireland. That's really us in a nutshell. We kind of always say we're almost like a dating site for charities.
Excellent.
It's an opportunity for them to increase their networks and meet new people who would be able to share their skills and their expertise at board and committee level.
And do you support all types of charities, all sizes of charities?
Yeah, exactly. So we work with all size charities around the country and with their board recruitment needs and training as well, of course. And I think sometimes charities don't really know where to go to find someone new, and they usually go through their kind of existing networks, maybe who they know who are already involved in the organization. So Boardmatch very much exists to be able to introduce them to new people, to look outside your existing networks and to kind of go beyond cast that net a little bit wider. And so that's what the website is there for. So it's our main service is our board recruitment website that's entirely free to use for any charity or not for profit. So all they need to do is create a profile and outline what they're looking for, and then they can connect with individuals who want to volunteer their time on a charity board or committee.
So you effectively do, as the name suggests, Boardmatch Ireland. You match individuals who are maybe interested and willing to make themselves available to join charities with organisations who are looking, to have a particular skill set on their board.
Exactly, yeah. And I think particularly over the last couple of years, charities have started to be a little bit more strategic with how they look for people for their board. So as you say, they're looking for particular skills, people who have particular perspectives or backgrounds that will help them to, future-proof the organisation and make sure that they have the right skills and perspectives around the board table to be able to deliver on their services.
Excellent. A really, really valued service. And I know I've heard some very positive feedback about the work that your organisation does and, helping to make that match where it's a win-win for the individual, a win-win for the charity in question. I know that during Charity Trustees Week, you have two events happening during the week. And I know both events are going to be recorded, so they'll be made available for those people who are unable to attend when they've been delivered. But one of them is focused on how to join a charity board. So maybe we'll just talk a little bit about that. How do you join a charity board? How does an individual go about it?
Yeah, so I mean, there's obviously a couple of different avenues. Of course, I'll be speaking to the Boardmatch way to find a charity board role. But what I would always say to someone who's thinking about volunteering on a board, it's about doing a little bit of self-reflection first. So thinking about what it is that you're interested in. Is there a particular area of the charity sector that you're interested in? What skills do you have to offer? And I mean skills in the broadest sense of the word as well. I think sometimes people think you have to be an accountant or you have to have a legal background to be on a board. But no, boards are looking for people with a whole range of skills and expertise. So it's helpful to kind of do a little bit of a reflection to think, okay, what do I have to offer in terms of skills, whether that's life experience or professional experience, what it is that I'm interested in, and what time do I have to give as well. So what I would say is if someone's interested in volunteering, there are a couple of things to think about beforehand. So you make sure that you're, prepared and you're on the kind of right foot in terms of starting that board journey. And then from a practical sense, how to actually find the role. I previously talked about how the website works, and that was more so from a charity perspective, but the website works two ways, so candidates can sign up as well. So if you're thinking about volunteering, you can create a profile, you can outline your work history to date, your a bit about yourself personally, something professionally, and then outlining what you're interested in terms of what area of the charity sector. And you can look at the vacancies or the board roles that are advertised currently, and also charities can reach out to you as well. So they might be looking for someone with finance skills. If you've listed that on your profile, they can reach out to you and say, oh, we see you're living in our area and you have finance skills, we'd love to start a conversation. So it really is about just putting yourself forward, thinking about what it is that you have to give, and then through the Boardmatch platform it kind of opens it up, providing a range of opportunities that you can look at and see what is the best fit for you. And we usually have We advertise just over 500 board roles a year on the platform. So there's a huge range in that. So everything from your large national organisations and to small community groups and everything in between.
And you referenced, Hannah, that starting that conversation, which is kind of key, isn't it, in this? Because it's about the fit between what the organisation needs in relation to its trustees, but also, you know, what the individual in question is looking for from the engagement and from the participation in the organisation.
Yeah, and I, at the end of the day, it's a volunteer role, so it has to be a good fit. You know, you're going to be taking time out of your, of you know, usually people's very busy lives to give your time in a voluntary capacity to be on the board. So it's really important to have a good fit on both sides. So, you know, that is really kind of the linchpin of the whole process. So what I would always say to someone who's looking at a role on the website or looking at any board role, you know, don't be afraid to start that conversation. And really, it's a two-way interview process whenever you're kind of, you know, meeting with people who work or volunteer in the charity. And it's about finding out what you can give to them, but also what you can get from the experience as well. You know, you want a volunteer role to be fulfilling. So not only can you give back in terms of your skills and your expertise, but you can also learn something from the experience. And you can, you know, meet people who you maybe never get a chance to work with in another capacity, or you can learn new skills and being in a boardroom environment.
And sometimes that conversation, when it starts, it may involve an individual maybe not necessarily becoming a trustee immediately. They might find a particular role within the organisation just to ease themselves into the organisation, and then actually over time then evolve into a trustee role. So that can happen, can't it, as a part of the relationship?
Yeah, we've seen that as well. And, you know, sometimes, particularly in maybe in smaller community organisations, people have been involved in a different capacity. Maybe it's more kind of hands-on volunteering, and then they hear about a potential role that might come up on the board. What we also see is a growing number of charities, you know, setting up committees of their board, and that's a great way to get involved in a way that's almost like a step down from the board. So you don't have the same level of legal duties and responsibilities, but it's still a great way to kind of find out what it's like, you know, behind the doors of the charity, you know, what is needed to help the charity to tick over. And you can still get involved in a voluntary capacity, but it doesn't have the same level of legal duties as being a charity trustee as well. So that's a really great way. And then sometimes people can transition from a committee onto the board if they wish to at a later stage.
Yeah, a good way to introduce yourself if you're a little bit concerned about the responsibility that goes with being a trustee, maybe to ease yourself into the organisation, observe how it operates, you know, how it functions and so on. And it might actually help inform as well your role as a trustee if you, you know, if you like, move on to into becoming a trustee, help you provide greater insight, I suppose, in that
exactly.
In that role. Hannah, the second event which Boardmatch Ireland is facilitating during Charity Trustees Week is in relation to balancing board and management functions. Can you tell us a little bit about the challenges, I suppose, you know, associated with that balancing act, and maybe even just characterising maybe the difference between board and management functions?
Yeah, and I think this is a tricky one. And the reason actually we're running this is because it was actually a direct request from a lot of trustees when we were looking for some input into what they would like to see during Charity Trustees Week. So we designed this with that in mind. You know, it was something that clearly some boards were struggling with. And I've seen that even on the board that I'm on as well. And I think it happens in all sized organizations, but maybe sometimes more so in smaller ones. But actually, really, it is across the board. And I think it can happen in different ways. And I think it's difficult, particularly if a charity has limited resources, to be able to kind of draw that line sometimes, because sometimes the board do need to get a little bit more hands on in terms of how they engage. But what we find is an organization is kind of best suited to be able to kind of grow and develop if you do very much clearly kind of delineate that line between the board and so strategy and governance and management and the kind of day-to-day operations. So it can be hard to do, and definitely, and I think that's something that we'll definitely talk about in the session, is it's going to be based on kind of real life examples that we've received from people in advance of the webinar. But it's really about ensuring that the board understand that the responsibility lies with them. you know. So you can go from both extremes. You either have a really hands-off board who just goes along with everything that the management proposes. And of course, you want to have confidence and faith in whoever your management or your staff are. But of course, it's the board at the end of the day who are the ones who are responsible for the organization. Or you can go the other way, extreme, to, you know, you have a completely over-involved board who get very involved in the day-to-day. And that can slow down board meetings. It can mean that it can maybe confuse sometimes management and staff around what their responsibilities are. So it's about communication. It's about, you know, being, you know, really honest and transparent with your, with any of your staff or your volunteers about why, you know, these controls need to be in place and why it's, you know, in the best interest of the organization. So it really is about having clear, you know, outlined role specs for everybody who's involved, whether you're in the field volunteer or whether you're a staff member or whether you're a board member, and trying to support them and, you know, elevate them in their role, but without getting too far into to one extreme or the other. So it can be difficult to do and challenging, particularly in, you know, a moment of crisis. Maybe the board does have to be quite hands on and get a little bit more involved and operational. But it's more important for the board to kind of take that step back, have that kind of strategic oversight of the organization to ensure that they can, you know, objectively look at what's going on day to day and see how they can, you know, develop that into the future as well.
And I suppose, Hannah, you referenced for smaller organisations where there may not have staff in place, that the lines can be a little bit blurred. You know, so you've got your voluntary trustees who also then are probably involved in some elements of the management. But as organisation, on that continuum, I suppose, of charities, the ones then that are the larger ones where you've got more of a definition of, they've got staff resources, they've got a board, they've got a management team in place as well, you would expect that clarity of the roles really to be clearer. But it is something, I suppose, that the trustees need to reflect on, isn't it? They're understanding the difference between their role as trustees and the management of the organisation.
Yeah, and I think no organisation is immune to it. And I think even the larger organisations, sometimes it can be hard for a trustee to know what their role is in a board meeting. You know, if you have really competent staff and management people who are, you know, attending these meetings and presenting, you know, the board might feel, well, they're doing a great job, so I should kind of agree with them. So sometimes it's hard for the board member to understand that they need to constructively challenge and, you know, be involved at a strategic level and, you know, do feel that, you know, they are asking the right questions and being involved in the board meetings in the correct way to ensure that they're showing their oversight and executing their oversight. And as you say, in smaller organizations, sometimes you don't actually have any paid staff and it can all be volunteer led. And we find with that, sometimes what we kind of say, we have a trainer who actually is facilitating the session for us. And she has a great phrase about, you know, what hat you're wearing in the meeting. And so you might be an in the field volunteer, but, you know, if you're at a board meeting and you're talking about something to do with strategy, you know, you need to be wearing your board hat at that stage, and it's about kind of perspective as well. And then if you obviously, if you maybe are involved in, you know, fundraising or volunteering in a more hands-on way, you know, that is something that you're involved in, but maybe it's not for the board meeting, you know, it's for another part, it's for another way that you're involved. So it's just about what hat you're wearing at different times about when you're involved in the organization, and that will help hopefully to, again, even a smaller organization, allow them to make that difference between governance and management.
That's very sound advice. Tell us a little bit about your own journey, Hannah, as a charity trustee.
Sure. So I'm a charity trustee on the board of the Irish National Youth Ballet Company. And I joined them in February 2020. So that was a very unusual time to join a performing arts organisation because, of course, COVID happened a few weeks after my first board meeting. And with a youth dance company, you know, the kind of primary thing that we deliver are, you know, public performances. And so everyone was gearing up for the spring show that had to be obviously completely called off. So it was a couple of years as an organisation struggling with, you know, how we ensure that we're still, you know, providing a service to the dancers and providing a public benefit, but also at the same time, knowing that we're caught in these restrictions that, you know, understandably everyone was going through, particularly those who, you know, in the performing arts as well. And so it was a challenge definitely at the beginning. And I think also when I first joined the board, I would have been substantially younger than the next person on the board to me. And so that was something personally that I found a positive challenge, but a challenge definitely to find my role on the board and to find my voice and to get confident in how I could engage in the board and what expertise was I bringing, even though I felt in one way that I was much less experience than a lot of the other board members. But I've really enjoyed being on the board over the last coming up on 4 years now. I stepped up as company secretary last year, and that's even been more of a learning curve too. And I think one thing I'm definitely going to be proud of when in a couple of years time, when my term is over, I think something I'll definitely be proud of is helping them to become compliant with the governance code, introducing policies and procedures and things I would have been familiar with in my day job in Boardmatch. That was definitely something that I was able to introduce to the charity. So that's something hopefully that will stand the test of time after I step down from the board later.
And the timing, Hannah, is quite interesting. You say there you joined in February 2020, just before COVID took off. And I'd imagine, you know, pre-COVID, you would have expected to probably have met your colleagues as trustees on the board, probably in person. But I assume that for quite a while, you were actually just meeting them online.
Exactly. Yeah. So I had one board meeting in person that I got to meet everyone. And then everything went online. And it was definitely something that this organization have never done before. They'd never done an online meeting. That was all new to us. And I think that's something that we've even seen in Boardmatch more broadly. You know, how do you engage in online capacity? You know, that sometimes can be difficult as well, you know, finding your voice in an online forum, you know. And so that was something that definitely we had to try and get used to. And then we recruited over the last couple of years. So there's still some board members who I have never seen in person, because we actually never went back to in-person meetings. And we ended up recruiting some people who were, whilst the company is technically based in Dublin, it's a national organisation. And we actually now have board members in Donegal and in Sligo. And so it actually means that we were able to broaden our skill sets and who we could invite to the board by, you know, being able to have our board meetings online, which is something we had never thought about before. But it does mean that sometimes you lose some of that, you know, the in-person element, the chit chat over the coffee before the board meeting, that kind of thing.
Sure.
But I was actually at a meeting with some of the board members just at the weekend there, and I got to meet one of the board members who had been on the board for just over 2 years for the first time. So that was really nice to meet him in person. So, you know, it has its challenges, but it also has the benefits as well. In one way, easier to schedule in online meetings around your day and your other commitments. And what I personally like is I do like that kind of, you know, the human side of it too. And one thing I really enjoy is going to see the dancers in their, you know, biannual performances.
Excellent. Yeah. So it's trying to get the balance right, isn't it? And maybe, you know, I think a lot of organizations now probably move to a mix of online and in-person, especially more maybe regional or national organizations where their trustees are kind of coming from different parts of the country. It was interesting there, your reference there about you being maybe a good bit younger than other trustees when you joined the board. Do you think there's more that can be done to attract younger people into organisations? Because I think the age profile of trustees in general is probably, you know, a bit older. Is there more that can be done to attract younger people?
Definitely. I definitely agree with that. And I mean, from a personal capacity, but also Boardmatch, you know, what we try to do with our services as well is to introduce it to more people who wouldn't consider themselves to be traditionally board members. And I think the last research was from a few years ago, maybe 2 or 3 years ago, but the last research showed that the average age of a board member, a charity board member in Ireland, was 57 years old. So there's a lot of work to be done to reduce that. And of course, you know, that's just an average. But in Boardmatch, over the last number of years, our average age has been more around kind of the 44 years old. So a good bit younger than that national average. And, you know, every year we always kind of are able to introduce some stats into our annual report around some of the demographics of who are joining boards through Boardmatch. And it can be, I think last year our youngest was 20 or 21 and our oldest appointment was in their early 70s. So what we're trying to do by having kind of an open forum where people can advertise their roles and put themselves forward, it's hopefully opening up the boardroom to people who maybe wouldn't have originally considered themselves to be board members. And I think charities have a lot to do as well in terms of how they advertise and how they articulate the role and also how they prepare their trustees as well. So sometimes someone who doesn't have previous board experience and is maybe younger or earlier in their professional career might need a little bit more hands-on support when they join the board. They're well able to join a charity board, but they might just need a little bit more encouragement. So I think there's a certain amount of responsibility on charities to step up to that and to be able to support people who don't have previous board experience or people who are earlier in their career. And actually, one thing I was very proud to work on this year in Boardmatch in collaboration with The Wheel was our Future Board Leaders program that we introduced in February. And that was specifically for people who wouldn't consider themselves traditionally to be a board member. So whether that was to do with their age or their gender or their race or their social background. And we had an open call for people to put themselves forward. And it was more of an assisted program where they received training, and we were all able to kind of meet in a group twice and to really kind of prepare them for their role and provide a level of mentoring and support for, to take on their first board role.
Fantastic.
So we
had
22 people on the program, and we're still finalizing the placements, but we've had 15 placements to date. So it's been really great for our first program, and also to see charities engage with it and want to bring new voices and perspectives onto their board, whatever that might be.
Excellent.
So I think age is a huge part, but there's lots of different things to consider still for charity boards to diversify them further.
Very good, Hannah. That's really interesting. And best of luck this week during Charity Trustees Week with your events, which I know will be recorded. Will they be available through Boardmatch Ireland website, or is it through the charitiesregulator.ie?
Yeah, so if you go onto the Charity Regulator's website, they'll be updating the calendar with the recording link.
Excellent. So best of luck with that. And thank you so much for joining us today. That's Hannah Coleman, Communications and Education Manager with Boardmatch Ireland.
For more information about Charity Trustees Week, check out www.charitiesregulator.ie.
And I'm now delighted to be joined on the line by Alan Cox, who is a trustee with AsIAm, and Keith McCarthy, who's a trustee with Outhouse. You're both very welcome to the programme.
Thanks very much. Nice, good to be here.
Thank you.
Thanks, Keith. I might start with you, Alan, and tell us a little bit about why you became a trustee and how you got involved with AsIAm.
Yes, about 5 years ago, a friend of mine, Una O'Herlihy, who's on the board of AsIAM, approached me and asked me would I be interested in getting involved. We both shared the fact that we have autistic children, and my eldest daughter, Michelle, is autistic. So I jumped at the chance, really, because I wanted to be able to make a contribution, and that's really how it happened.
So it was through a personal contact, someone you knew who kind of came to you, is that it? And basically
that's correct,
felt,
yes.
Yeah. And what's the experience been like? Tell us about how it's gone for you.
Well, it's been a wonderful experience. I mean, being a trustee of a charity and being a member of the board is a wonderful honour, really. And it's a very important role. I mean, the role of the trustee in a charity is a very responsible role and a very important role for the future health of the charity. And I've enjoyed that process immensely. I joined the board 5 years ago, and then 2 years ago, I was elected to be the chairperson. So that brought me into a new area of responsibility. And the charity AsIAM is growing at an extraordinary rate. So the role of the board is very important in helping to guide it towards its vision and also to ensure that its governance is watertight. And we work with a wonderful group of 12 directors on the board, 12 trustees, and then the team within AsIAM, of which there are 28, are just doing an outstanding job. And it's a real privilege and pleasure for me to be involved.
So it's a relatively large organisation then. I know there's much, much larger charities, but you've got a board of 12, staff of 28. So it's a medium sized, I suppose, charity. Would that be fair to say, Alan?
Yes, that's right. And its growth level is quite extraordinary. This is the 10th year of the charity we're coming into now, the 10th year anniversary. And it grew from just Adam basically, creating an opportunity for people to meet online and share information about autism. That was the beginning of the charity 10 years ago. And now it's making an extraordinary impact. And, in the last 12 months, 5,300 people have engaged with AsIAM's services. That in itself is up from 3,900 the previous year. So you can get a sense of the growth of the organization. And in that context, the role of the board is very important. And one of the reasons that we have 12 people on the board is because of the need to ensure that we have the right skill set to help guide the charity and also to create the very important opportunity for subcommittees to be established, which I think are an extremely important part of the board and its work.
It's a theme we're hearing about from different contributors to the programme today, the importance of having that diversity in relation to gender, in terms of age, in terms of skill set, etc. on the board. It's really, really important, isn't it?
it's very important. It's absolutely crucial that you have the right skill set. So what we do on an annual basis is we review the skill set of the board to ensure that we don't have any gaps in relation to, you know, the experience and the expertise that we require. You know, in the last 12 months, we've recruited additional members of the board to fill in particular gaps that we felt had emerged in our skill set. And it's very important to review that annually.
Very good. And Keith, you're deputy chairperson of Outhouse LGBTQ plus Centre in Dublin.
That's correct.
Yeah. And tell us a little bit about your journey in terms of becoming a trustee.
Yeah, absolutely. So I suppose about 3 years ago, I had decided from a maybe personal development perspective, actually, to join a board. And I had worked with a consultant for quite a long time, working with boards and organizations. And I also had an interest in the concept of it. So I suppose I went on to Boardmatch, actually. And I spent a lot of time, I suppose, looking through different organizations that were looking for new boards and so on, for board members. And it took me a while to figure out, I suppose, really what I wanted and where my skill sets could be of use. And Outhouse advertised on Boardmatch. And I thought that's, firstly, you know, I'm a member of the LGBTQ plus community. So it's I had a natural alignment to that. And I had an interest in it. And they were looking for somebody with HR experience as well, which I suppose aligned with my own background, too. So I suppose it was something that I had set out to do. It took me a while to find something that I had, an organization that I had an interest in, which I think is really important as well, that you have to have an interest, I suppose, really in the organization that you go to join as a board member. So 3 years ago, or two and a half years ago, I applied. I met with the board at the time, who were there, and they made the decision to, I suppose, accept me onto the board, for use of a better expression. And we carried out the processes associated with that. So it was something that I wanted to do from a personal perspective, so that I could broaden my own skills and broaden my own experience and use my own experiences to actually support the organization and what it was trying to achieve.
Yeah, and that piece, Keith, that you say about that, you know, the interest in the organization is key, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because, you know, there is work. It's not you're not just sitting on a board that, you know, that's just listening to updates from management. You know, I'm sure for both of you, it's quite an active engagement and consideration of lots of different issues. But at the same time,
once you've got the interest, it's
really rewarding, isn't that right? It's quite rewarding.
Absolutely. Like, it has to be something that you have an interest in, and it has to be something that you feel as you want to add value. And one day, I suppose, when I was engaging with the members of the board as part of my application process, I just thought that, like, it is about value adding, and it's about making sure that, you know, that my skills can be utilized, my experiences can be utilized, and that I can use that to help the organization with its governance and making sure that the organization is delivering for in terms of delivering on the strategy and delivering for the members that are engaging with it. So it absolutely has to be something that you have an interest in, because you are giving up of your time. And therefore, it has to be something that is of interest to you, and that you will, I suppose, that you're passionate about, I suppose, really, if that makes
yeah.
sense.
And Alan, that's key, isn't it? That's kind of a win-win situation for both the individual trustee and the organisation. That's really what we're trying to achieve, isn't it, in terms of recruiting trustees?
Yes, I mean, certainly having an interest in what the organisation is doing is essential. But also, it's really important to have a commitment to the role of being a trustee, because it is a big commitment and it carries with it a lot of responsibility. And therefore, it's very important that all the trustees are fully engaged and committed to the job that they're doing to ensure that we're following through on our obligations. And that's really important. I worry sometimes, thankfully I haven't come across it myself, but I do worry that, you know, are some boards populated by people who are interested in what the organization is doing, but not all that committed to the very onerous task of being a trustee and ensuring that you're getting under the skin of what the organization is doing and have eyes on all aspects of what its obligations and roles are. And that's really important.
Just to build on that as well, I think it's important that people really understand that the responsibility that the trustees or the board members are actually taking on, because, you know, it is a really, really important role in terms of the governance of the organization. And I think, you know, people need to understand how important that role is, both in terms of, you know, the contribution to engage with the executive and the team, you know, in the organization, but for overall good governance and making sure that the organization is doing what it's supposed to be doing and doing it appropriately. So it is a really, really important role for the organization and for the beneficiaries to ensure that everything is being done above board, if that makes sense as well. Sure. So it is a really important role.
And I suppose there is a that piece as well, isn't there, about balancing the board functions and the management functions of the organization. Isn't that just really important? I'm sure both of you, as Alan, as chair of AsIAm, and Keith, you as deputy chair of Outhouse, you know, I'm sure you have a very close relationship with the management of both organizations. But it's important that there's clear boundaries as well, isn't there, between the board trustees and the management?
Yeah, we do have set down exactly where the board's responsibilities start and end, and where management's begin and end. And it's very important that you have that clarity. Sometimes, however, it's hard, you know, not to get involved in some of the operational matters. And I personally have to check myself and, you know, stop myself from sometimes going further than, you know, the chair should do in order to ensure that there's proper delineation between the role of the board and the executive. And that probably comes from, you know, being a chief executive for many years myself. Sometimes I have to remind myself where that line is. But thankfully, AsIAm have a fantastic senior management team. And Adam Harris is just an extraordinary chief executive. So the need to do that is not there, thankfully.
And I think that's a similar situation in Outhouse as well. I mean, there's myself and eight other trustees on the board, and we would engage, you know, quite a lot with the CEO. He needs to understand, and he does understand that we are there for him if he needs it. He can pick up the phone, he can ring us in terms of, you know, we have a very diverse skill set amongst us in terms of finance, HR, you know, all sorts of different areas of running an organization. So Oisin, as our CEO, like, is, you know, he understands that he can contact us if required for advice, for guidance, for support, but us also understanding like what our roles of trustees are and what his role in terms of leading the team are. And we have a fantastic team in Outhouse, an absolutely excellent team, which is fantastic. But we also have to be there as a support for them if they need us as well, but understanding the boundaries.
Both of you have referenced there the importance of that support for management, but also, I suppose, the importance of not being afraid to challenge. And you referenced, I think, maybe a little bit earlier, Alan, to dig deep into the organisation and maybe some of the issues that are there from a management perspective. So that's important as well, isn't it, Keith, that you're not afraid to challenge as a trustee as well. It's important to ensure that you do that.
Absolutely. At the end of the day, we're responsible for the governance of the organization, and you know, our job, we meet about 10 times a year, along with the addition of the subcommittees and stuff like that, and part of our role essentially is to challenge, is to question, as well as giving, you know, advice and guidance where required. But that is our responsibility. When we sign up to be a director and a trustee of the organization, what you're signing up to do is sort of say, right, you know, how do we make sure that this organization has been governed appropriately, that decisions are made within the best interests of both the organization and the service users of the organization as well. So you're absolutely right. That is our role, is to challenge and to make sure that we are comfortable that everything is appropriate. And we've done a lot of work in Outhouse over the last number of years to make sure that our governance structures and processes are absolutely robust and really, really, I suppose, effective in terms of running the organization. So you're absolutely right. It is really, really important that you do challenge, do question, and have confidence then in the decisions that are made.
Yes, I think that's really important. And you need to actually see the team in action. You know, the board can't be completely separate from the organization. It's very important for the board to see the team in action, to get to know the people involved in the management team and throughout the organization, and to get a real sense of what they're doing. And sometimes I think we can step a bit further back than we should as boards in relation to, you know, getting to know what's going on day to day. But it's a very fine line. It really is, because the last thing you want to do is to stand on toes or to be seen to be, you know, looking over somebody's shoulder and that kind of thing. So it's about getting that balance right.
Excellent, yeah. And I suppose with experience as well, you know, I suppose being on the board, that it comes a little bit more naturally, maybe in terms of, you know, the boundaries and ensuring that you're managing the relationship with your managers and with your staff, etc., and with your colleagues as well on the board. But Alan and Keith, thank you so much for joining us today. It's been really interesting hearing about your journey, I suppose, in terms of becoming a trustee and then obviously taking on the role of chairperson and deputy chair within your respective organisations. And I should say that if anyone wants to learn more about both organisations, you can visit www.asiam.ie and outhouse.ie. But again, Alan and Keith, thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you very much.
Check out www.pobal.ie for more information about Pobal.
And I'm delighted now to be joined on the line by Anna Shakespeare, who is CEO of Pobal. And I should say, in addition to my volunteer role with Community Radio, that I'm also an employee of Pobal. Anna, you're very welcome to our special programme celebrating Charity Trustees Week.
Thanks a million, Ronan. Thanks for the invite.
Now, delighted to have you on. And Pobal obviously is one of the stakeholders and partners with the Charities Regulator in relation to Charity Trustees Week and is sponsor of this particular broadcast along with CRAOL. But first of all, Anna, it'd be interesting maybe just to share with our listeners a little bit about Pobal and what the organisation is about.
Thanks, Ronan. So look, Pobal is sort of one of those organisations that, you know, most people might have heard of and say, yeah, I know what they do, but are not really sure what we actually do. So look, we're around 30 years this year, as you may be aware, and we work on behalf of the Irish government and the European Union and in conjunction with communities and local agencies with the ambition to support social inclusion and local community development. Our day-to-day job and how we do this is by managing funding, administrative supports and services that support about 41 programmes, schemes and services right across Ireland in the areas of social inclusion and equality, inclusive employment and enterprise, and early learning and care. And this year in 2023, we will allocate in excess of €1 billion on behalf of the Government of Ireland. We're a values-driven organisation. One of the reasons I work there is because of the type of work that we do. And I think that's very common amongst all the people that, you know, I meet within Pobal who work within Pobal. It's our vision to create an equal inclusive society in partnership with government and communities. So we're very much the bridge out to the community for government funding and supporting government programmes to be implemented by many of the heroes on the ground that, you know, are charity trustees, Ronan.
And that bridge to local communities, as you've characterised it, Anna, that involves relationships probably with hundreds and thousands of charities across the state. So there's a huge dependency there, isn't it, on a lot of charities, a relationship to deliver services, to provide supports in disadvantaged communities. So how important is the work of trustees in this regard?
You know, the importance of trustees is at the heart of them ensuring that they understand their role is ensuring the organisation has good governance in place. And, you know, it's key to the distribution and management of public funds from a Pobal perspective. So, you know, what does good governance look like? So from a charity trustee's perspective, it looks like you know what's happening in the organisation. You understand the funding streams that are coming in. You have comfort and you're reassured that the money is being used by the, you know, the team on the ground for the purposes for which it's intended, you know, to benefit the local community, to benefit individual participants on the different programmes, and to support that whole vibrant approach to, you know, social economy, social development.
Very good, Anna. And Pobal is celebrating its 30th anniversary this year. What difference have trustees made in relation to promoting social inclusion and disadvantage over that period? Because things have shifted a lot, haven't they, over that time? And probably, you know, even in that time, we've had the creation of the Charities Regulator. You know, there's various different, you know, maybe compliance elements that wouldn't necessarily have been there maybe, you know, 30 years ago.
Well, I think the landscape has changed hugely. Look, when Pobal was established in 1992, Ronan, its job was to manage European Union grants and to disperse them on behalf of the Government of Ireland. Today, we administer 41 programmes specifically designed to promote social inclusion and combat disadvantage. And we can see the state is making a huge investment. And trustees are the people that don't get paid for their work. They're voluntary in their role. They carry a big burden now, as you've rightly said, in comparison to the burden they would have been asked to take on maybe 10 or 15 years ago. So we've had a lot of legislative change over the period, all to the good, I would say, because it brings an openness and a transparency to how raised charitable funds are that are raised through the hard work of the local community, and they're actually used for those intended purposes out on the ground. Unfortunately, we have seen some very stark examples of where sometimes that has gone wrong. And I suppose the role of Charity Trustees Week is, from my perspective, is very much setting out how individuals as a trustee bring their skills, their knowledge and their competence to the boardroom, ask the right questions of the team who are implementing on the ground, support them in their work, make sure there's a strategy in place that is designed to deliver impact on the ground, and bring that local knowledge, that community spirit to the boardroom table, where you can see that you're making a contribution to your own local community by ensuring that the organisation is well run and managed, and that it makes an impact on the ground, and that there are outcomes for the local community or the individuals living within that community as a result.
And I know, Anna, outside of your role as CEO of Pobal, you were also involved as a trustee yourself. And tell us a little bit about the type of involvement and that journey for you.
I've always volunteered, like many of your listeners, Ronan. I think you have a moral obligation, if you can afford the time, to give back to the local community, to give back to and participate in that community spirit. So I'm involved in a couple of voluntary boards as a director or as a charity trustee. I'm company secretary for one of them. And my experience is that, you know, you need to know what's happening. You need to operate on a fully informed basis. You also need to let the executive team or the team whose job it is to do the job get on with the job and not second guess them in relation to the job. That you support them, and then you also check and challenge in a very supportive way. So you ask the right questions when you're sitting around that charity trustees table, that you know how much money you have in the bank, you understand how it's been spent, that you're ethical and supportive in the treatment of any employees that you might have, that you ensure that, you know, the service that's being delivered is the best quality that it can be, and that you ensure that, in particular, you know, the money that is being either given through grants from the state or generated through donations or fundraised is used for its intended purpose. And I suppose tonight, for example, I'm going to a meeting of one of the voluntary boards where I'm a member. And one of the things on the agenda tonight is to look at our return to the Charities Regulatory Authority, you know, confirming, you know, that we're compliant in many areas, but there's a couple of areas where we still have some work to do. And I think that's the important thing that charity trustees need to understand, is that they make sure that while you might be contributing to your local community, that there is a formal aspect to the work that you need to do in ensuring that the charity is operating within the rules, within the law, and it's not that difficult to do. I often have heard Helen Martin in the Charities Regulatory Authority CEO commenting that if you have a good agenda setting out the main elements of our money, how we manage risk, how we look at the service and our staffing, and if you document those in minutes, in many respects, you're covering off a lot of the things that you need to cover as a charity trustee. Yeah. And I would think that as a trustee myself, I've certainly found some of the practical guidance that they offer on their website to be really helpful and useful in guiding me in my job as a volunteer charity trustee.
Yeah, and I think that's, you know, you referenced, Anna, yourself there, how the role has maybe changed over the last 10 or 15 years in particular. Mm. And there's, you know, maybe more responsibilities. But equally, there's more supports and resources out there as well to assist trustees and boards in executing their role. So it's important, I think, that you've highlighted that there, you know, in terms of the Charities Regulator and some of the supports that are available on their website, but others as well who are partners within the process, including Pobal, pobal.ie, for, you know, in terms of, I know, the Managing Better series of guides that was done to support good governance in community and voluntary organisations, but also others such as Boardmatch, etc., who have been involved. And that piece, Anna, finally, you know, that check and challenge, that just strikes me as a really, really important piece, you know, because it is, of course, about supporting the organisation, the executive, but also there's times where board members do need to ensure that they check and that they're not afraid to challenge.
Absolutely. And I'm not talking about confrontation. In my day job, I report to a board myself, and I would expect them to ask me questions and to double check things with me, and then ask them if, you know, why something isn't so, and give a reasonable explanation as to why, so that they have a full understanding, because, again, the board of Pobal are volunteers, and, you know, also to, you know, to pay respect to them in that regard, they give of their time voluntarily. And they also come to the table having read all the board documentation. I think that's critical, that you, as a charity trustee, you make sure you read all the documentation before you turn up at the meeting, so that you can engage with the, you know, the management team or the executive team and ask them the questions that you should be asking them, so you actually know what's happening in the organisation where you are a trustee.
Very good.
Really important.
And on that note, Anna, thank you so much for joining us today. It's been really useful and interesting just to hear about your insights as the CEO of Pobal, who has responsibility for the management of such a large amount of public funding on behalf of the state and the EU, but also in terms of your personal experience as a voluntary trustee as well.
Thanks, Ronan. And before I go, just to let your listeners know that Pobal will be hosting an online event this week as part of our celebration of Charity Trustees Week. And it's about how to use the Pobal Deprivation Index to support grant funding applications. And look, many of your listeners will be interested in that, because we use the Deprivation Index with many of our programmes to ensure that, you know, areas that are more disadvantaged than others get the opportunity for maybe a higher grant allocation. So I think that's important for your listeners to be aware of.
And thank you so much. That's Anna Shakespeare, CEO of Pobal. And that's it from our special programme celebrating Charity Trustees Week 2023. I want to thank all our guests for sharing their experiences with us today. It was fantastic to hear from Helen Martin of the Charities Regulator, Hannah Coleman of Boardmatch Ireland, Keith McCarthy of Outhouse, Alan Cox of AsIAm, and Anna Shakespeare, CEO of Pobal. Go to charitiesregulator.ie for information on all the various different events that are happening this week. And you can also keep up with what's happening at hashtag Trustees Week IRL. I'd like to thank Gráinne and the team here at Connemara Community Radio, who produced the programme on behalf of CRAOL and Pobal. And thank you all for listening.